Hey, everyone. I know it's been a really long time since I've done a live stream, and I really wanted to do a Lulberts episode this week, but unfortunately, couldn't wrangle any cats. So we're doing this for a little bit. And this is actually something that I was throwing together anyway, because I wanted to do like a formal video. And what I am going to do is I'm going to cut this out and make this a its own standalone video. And then after I'm done going through the points that I want to talk to after my rant, so to speak, we're going to probably hang out a little bit. By the way, how have you guys been? Hope you've been well. I have not been well. To kind of give you a little bit of a life update before we start, I had broken my foot at work. I am a mental health technician, and I work in a psychiatric hospital. And during an altercation, me and a few other people got injured at work. I got bit on the neck. I got headbutted, and somehow in the process, I broke my foot. And so I am currently on day shift light duty at work, which is fun because I'm just a natural night owl anyway. And my circadian rhythm is completely thrown off, and I have work tomorrow morning. So yay. Yes. And hail Satan and all that jazz. So I want to talk a little bit about the Libertarian Party and why I am against it. And it's not the usual stuff that, you know, they're not real libertarians, or they're a bunch of Nazis that taken over, or it was always overrun by communists and the establishment stuff. And to an extent, some of those criticisms like are fine. But I'm going to talk a little bit about why the Libertarian Party will never be successful. It will never be a viable party. Ever, 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 no matter what you think, no matter what you want. It would be nice to have an actual libertarian party that, never mind. Everything's good. It's a long story. It's a long story. But anyways, I'm going to ignore chat for a little bit until I get through this diatribe, and then we'll catch up on chat and see what you guys say. Keep talking though. I do not know why. The chat box is hidden. Sorry about that. Should be working now, allegedly. Anyways. So I don't think the Libertarian Party will ever be a viable party. I think it's about as viable as trying to get the Communist Party that's pretty much overrunning everything in China to allow for a second party and actually have a fair election. It's about zero. It's about zero. And I'm going to explain why. And not only that, but I also think the Libertarian Party is overall bad for libertarians. Just absolutely bad for libertarians. And it has nothing to do with like the Mises takeover or anything like that. I think something like that was inevitable. And I think overall, all things considered, it's a good thing. I'm not exactly a big fan of a lot of the things that they do. I'm not a big fan of a lot of things they say, but that is another topic for another video. It doesn't matter who controls the Libertarian Party. It doesn't matter if the Beltways get in charge or the classical liberals take charge. It doesn't matter if the communists take charge. It doesn't matter if the alt-right takes charge. It doesn't matter if you get like some hardcore ANCAPs that just completely take over the party and convert everybody in the party to ANCAPistan. It does not matter. I think that this applies across the board. It does not matter who runs the party. It's never going to work electorally. I should qualify that. And I do think that it's a net harm, and there is absolutely no way to fix it. I know this is going to sound really black-pilled, but I assure you, I think that the future is very bright for liberty. I think things are going to get better, not worse, for liberty. But it's just very black-pilled specifically about the Libertarian Party, at least their stated goals. I think there are some axillary goals that are good. And it doesn't matter if the Libertarian Party platform is consistent with, it doesn't matter if the platform is consistent with libertarian philosophy. It doesn't matter. It's going to fail. Now, I think the one good thing that comes out of the Libertarian Party is that I'm gonna start with some compliments, and then we're gonna get into the things that I have disagreements with, that I think that are fundamentally flawed. That is like the death nail for the party, if your goal is to elect people. But first, a few compliments. I think to have a Libertarian Party that has a platform that is consistent with libertarian philosophy, even if there's a couple of faults here along the way or some minor disagreements on things about, well, not just minor, even major disagreements about something like abortion or something that libertarians are kind of conflicted on, I think that's good, because at the end of the day, when people go to look up, like, oh, what is this libertarian thing? The first thing that they're going to look for is the Libertarian Party platform. We've seen a lot of like YouTubers who make like debunking videos about the libertarian position, and what they do is they just cite the Libertarian Party platform, and a lot of the things that they take umbrage with are things that like a lot of libertarians are very conflicted about, like the way like school choice and stuff. There are some libertarians who are like, yeah, school choice is good. Some people say that it's awful. I am of the opinion that it's better but awful than what we have currently. But anyways, so I think that it's good in that respect, that there is somewhere that people can go, Libertarian Party, party platform, but the platform has to be consistent with libertarian philosophy, which it hasn't been for the longest time. I need to go over through it one more time and give it a look before I can actually make a statement of how it is now. It has been kind of rewritten. So number two, when they nominate a good person, and they're able to gain media attention for whatever reason, I think that's a good thing, because it gets the message out there. Like, the elections are basically a free platform. They're a free soapbox that's available to anybody. And most of it's not even on taxpayer dollars. A lot of it is just media coverage, just, you know, private media coverage that want to cover the candidates and see what's going on. And if they can get into the debates, great. You know, then that allows for that party to get onto television and allow people to experience what a libertarian actually has to say and how they object to the Democrat and Republican platform. Another good thing that I think is good is Phobes just pointed out in the chat, which I don't think the chat is showing up. Yeah, I don't know what's wrong with the chat. Wedge thing, it's not working. I'm sorry. I think it's probably because I'm logged into the wrong account on Streamlabs, but whatever. Actually, I think I am. Yeah, I think I'm actually on my old account. whatever. Is that, you know, a lot of the shit posting that they do on Twitter and social media platforms, and they engage in people having a conversation. A lot of people were very upset over the Meghan McCain tweet. At first, I was kind of like conflicted, but you know, after kind of talking to some other people, having a debate over it, I was kind of thoroughly convinced that it's actually a good thing, because now but at the time there was a big debate about John McCain's legacy and Meghan McCain's platform that she has, which I don't know how big it is now that she's not on The View. But all of the things that she talks about and defends, and whether or not it's a good thing. And that was a good way to get people talking about the issues. And the libertarian old guard can complain and bitch all they want about how it's destroying the party and making them look bad. But at the same time, what it's also doing is it's forwarding a conversation that the LP has never done. The only time that the LP has ever forwarded a conversation was usually in some sort of a bad light, like the time that they said the DPRK was a much more free country because they allowed weed legalization, even though that's not true. And even the article that they cited said that it's not true, but they still went on Twitter to say that it's weird that you have to go to the DPRK to find more freedom than America. That's insane. But shitposting like that does actually get some people talking, and that's a good thing. Even if they're angry, now they have to justify why they are angry and give an actual argument and think about it. And there's a lot of people who actually tried it, like, were mad initially. And then when they were asked, like, why is this a bad thing? They kind of go like, oh, wait, no, John McCain was a shitbag. Fuck him. Yeah. And fuck her. Fuck his daughter for saying, you know, for defending it and actually wanting more of the bad parts of his thing. Another good thing about the Libertarian Party, this is going to be my last compliment. The other good thing about the Libertarian Party is in some areas, it is a good way to network with other libertarians in your area. I know there's a lot of people who that's slowly not being the case anymore. But when I was younger, I was the only libertarian that I knew. And it wasn't until, you know, I was able to kind of reach out to various organizations and stuff like that. And the Libertarian Party was one of them. That I was actually able to meet some other people who were like-minded. And that was kind of nice to actually not be the only libertarian that I knew anymore. So here's two reasons I think that it's impossible for it to work electorally, to actually get people elected, to actually become an actual viable party. Even though right now the Libertarian Party is like the biggest third party in America, and it has the most elected officials, I think they account for, actually, let me get the numbers, because I actually had done the math to find out exactly what percentage they were in terms of elected officials. Let me see if I can get it real quick. Scroll up a little bit. Let's see. Oh boy, this is gonna. What the heck did that? Oh, here we go. So, just to put the LP in perspective, for those that think the LP is growing, sizable, or has a meaningful power or influence, there are 519,682 elected political seats in America. That is every elected official in the United States, local, federal, and state, and 103 of them are elected officials for the Libertarian Party. That is actually less than 0.06% of all elected officials in the United States. The LP as of right now has 693,634 members, as opposed to over 47 million in the DNC and over 35 million in the GOP. And it's also safe to say that people who tend to vote gold are usually going to be more likely a member of the LP than the people who vote red or blue. Most of them just vote red or blue and then call it a day, but they aren't actually official members of the party. Even with that nice little boost, they represent less than 2% of the size of the current two parties. And that's important. Because the LP will never be a viable party. They have the Democratic and the Republican parties have a stranglehold on how elections are basically gone in the United States. They control everything. They have what 90? What was this? Almost or like about 990? You know, like 99.9% of every elected office. There are some independents. There are some Green Party people, but not many. But the vast majority of them are Republicans and Democrats, and they're able to, you know, they're able to set the rules, and they're able to kind of set the rules on who gets on the ballot. They're able to set the rules on who gets to be on the debate stage. They set the rules about every single thing, and not only that, but they also control the narrative. They're the ones that, well, at least. They don't, but they essentially do, since most of the major media outlets are basically talking heads for political parties. Fox News and the Washington Times and stuff like that, they're basically outlets for the GOP. And then most of the major corporate press are basically mouthpieces for the Democratic Party. I don't think that's debatable, especially anymore. And they're the ones that can go on stage and say, hey, the Green Party, if you vote for the Green Party, it's basically a vote for the Republican Party. If you vote for the Libertarian Party, it's basically a vote for the Democratic Party. And they're able to control the narrative. And most people believe it. And then when you take a look at something like Ross Perot, who was probably the most successful candidate, third party candidate in living memory. I think he only walked away with, 13% of the vote. And he got a lot of coverage. I think he actually got probably more coverage than most of the other third parties in any election, including Gary Johnson, who was basically propped up by the mass media until, or the corporate press, until it became apparent that he was also going to take votes away from Hillary Clinton. And then they Aleppo'd him, is the best way of putting it. Now, it's not to say that, like, if you want to run in an election for, I don't know, the local city council of Durkistan, Idaho, that you're not going to get elected. It's very possible. There have been some people who have, and there are those people who are sitting, I think they actually have like one state senator, and I think it was in Tennessee, who's a real dumb shit who thinks that a governor is a federal position. But anyways, either way, they're not, it's not really a viable way to get elected. If you want to get elected, the best way to get elected as a libertarian, if your goal is to get libertarians elected, then your goal should be to push the GOP in a more libertarian way, or even the Democratic Party. And that's actually a more viable solution than the LP, believe it or not. And to get libertarians elected that way. In fact, most of the libertarians that we can think of that are major names in elected party politics are not members of the LP. They're Republicans. I think Kane from WWE, I think he is the mayor. I think he's under the Republican Party. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I know he's not a Libertarian Party member. Then you have, like Rand Paul, Justin Amash, who's since left the Republican Party, but he was, when he was elected, Republican, Justin Amash and that sort of, those sorts. And I think the, and not only that, but the GOP has enough money in their coffers to basically outspend the Libertarian Party 10 times over. And not only do they do that, they also know that they can waste money. They can spend money. They can waste money of their own, but it's not really wasting. They can spend money to get the Libertarian Party to waste money. In fact, in Texas, this just recently happened, and right now they are still asking for money for their legal fund because they are suing. I can't remember if they're suing the state of Texas or if they're suing the GOP for removing them from the ballot in Texas, which they won, and they're still in other court cases about it. And that was intentional. That was an intentional thing to stop the Libertarian Party from growing. And we've seen this happen time and time again, where a political party will remove the third party from the ballot and just to get them to sue and waste a bunch of money. That's money that could be spent on campaigning, on television ads, on billboards and yard signs and all this other stuff that's important to get your candidate elected. And you're just going to waste millions and millions of dollars in frivolous court cases, you know, or cases that are obvious, you know, that weren't legal. But they don't care because they have the time and energy and money to spend on these court cases. So they remove them from the ballot, welcome them to the court in order to stay on the ballot, get them to spend a bunch of money that they don't really have, and waste all of their time and money and energy and resources on a stupid lawsuit rather than actually getting any of their campaign donors to. And they have lots of dirty tricks up their sleeve since, again, they're the ones that control who gets on the ballot, who gets on the debate stage, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Now, it just recently happened in Georgia where the Libertarian Party was invited to debate on the debate stage. And sometimes that happens. Usually it's when the Democratic Party feels that the Republican Party is a threat to them, and so they invite on a bunch of libertarians to hopefully use them as a spoiler party. But GOP is also very hesitant, and they have just enough time, energy, and money to fight against that as well. It really depends on what the situation is and what party is basically in control of the state at the time. It's they're not going to get on any presidential debate stage. I think the GOP and the DNC is very dead set on that. And even when third parties have polled 5% or more, I'm thinking about Ralph Nader, he was actually, they actually bumped up the requirements in order to make sure that they don't get, so that he didn't get on the debate stage. Now, there's also an incentive problem. This is my second biggest problem, is because we can now look at it and say that it's not possible for the party to really have any meaningful growth, to not have any meaningful like wins. Every strategy that the Libertarian Party can execute in order to try to get to be a major party will fail. And because every major method will fail, it will always cause conflicts in the Libertarian Party in terms of strategy to fight with each other over who gets to control it. And anytime that there's like a new takeover, or anytime a new strategy is suggested, or anytime a new strategy is taken, you always get like most of the people in the party going, "Well, we already tried that. That doesn't work. We have to try our way because our way has worked." But the problem is like none of them will work. So it always causes like this intra-party conflict. And not only that, but a lot of these kind of unofficial groups kind of also form, and caucuses that also form, and their goals basically is to try to kind of sway people into their way of doing things. And what it ends up doing is just basically turning into like a very light version of the, you know, like a, it's probably not, it's probably like a little hyperbole, but it's basically like a verbal version of the Weimar Republic going on in the LP at all times. This has happened. It's happening now. Now that the Mises Caucus is taking control, you're having groups like the CLC, and you're having groups like, was it the Out Caucus or the Outright Caucus? You have groups like, I think the Audacious Caucus and stuff like that, which I think they're actually gone now, because since, you know, Vermin and James Weeks are gone, they're always constantly accusing the Mises Party of being Nazis. And then you have the Mises Caucus accusing all the people who are not in the Mises Caucus who are opposed to them as being, as being like leftists and communists. And this has always been the case in the Libertarian Party. These kind of factions have always been at odds with each other, and they always spend more time hating on each other and infighting rather than actually spreading the ideas of liberty. In fact, a lot of the times that you actually see a lot of these groups, they're spending most of their time infighting. And even when they're trying to make it seem like they're pushing the ideas of liberty, most of those tweets that they're doing are basically subtweets about the opposing groups that are kind of running opposition to them within the party. Or saying things that they know will piss them off, like constantly talking about how great democracy is and how bad a national divorce is, because it knows it'll trigger a lot of people in the Mises Caucus to give a response and to encourage infighting. And these incentives are built into any kind of political party that is not ever going to be successful. And again, since it's not possible for them to be a viable party, all strategies are failures, so they're always going to be pointing out how the other guys have a failing strategy. But a lot of these people that are in the Libertarian Party, like, this is basically their life. This is their only social group. The Libertarian Party at best is a social group masquerading as an actual viable political party. And so you have all these people that are vying for power in a party that has no power, thinking that they do have power. And, you know, like everybody in the party who gets any kind of elected, position, think they're the top shit. They think they're going to get like pussy rained upon them because, you know, they're the, I don't know, the secretary to the treasurer of the Bexar County Libertarian Party. And, you know, they kind of use that as like a weight and like a badge of honor that, you know, that they're so cool. And any time that, you know, that gets taken away, they start screaming and fussing and kicking and crying. And anybody who takes that stuff away from them, they're going to start immediately getting on Twitter and all this other stuff and accusing them of being Nazi. So you have all these people vying for power in a powerless organization. And there's no way of organizing the LP that will ever be successful. And all systems and all that they can possibly construct will fail. And because of that, they were going to be constantly infighting about how things should be ran in the LP. So that's why, you know, the libertarians the Libertarian Party just exists as an infighting machine, and that's all that'll ever turn it, that'll ever be. There are a few good things that come out of it, but I think overall, I think the negatives far outweigh the positives. Now, look, I think infighting is fine. I think generally speaking, I think infighting is a good thing. I think infighting has its benefits. There's ideas that need to be hashed out and to be debated. There's a lot of things internally within libertarians that people have disagreements over. Copyright, abortion, immigration. I think a lot of those things need to have their day on the debate stage in the libertarianism. And are saying that, you know, someone, you know, and having it pointed at one particular person, people would consider that infighting. A lot of people want to argue with Dave Smith for his very wrong position about immigration. But I think people should be able to, you know, go after him and debate him on that issue. I don't think that it's cool to associate him with Nazis and stuff like that. But I do think that maybe, hey, we should have the, and not only that, but they should also go over things that I think are right as well that he says, and have that debate. Those are good examples of infighting. But a lot of the infighting is basically like, you disagree with me on 0.0001%. You're a Nazi. You're a communist. You're basically like a GOP operative. You're basically like a Democrat pretending to be, what, and on and on and on. So these infighting will never stop. They're just going to keep dividing libertarians into separate groups over and over and over again. And not even that, but even people outside of the Libertarian Party want to constantly fight with people inside the Libertarian Party, and people inside the Libertarian Party think that, you know, this is the best thing since sliced bread. And they're going to constantly attack people outside of the party as well. So that is why I believe that the Libertarian Party is a completely futile thing to get involved with, if your goal is to get libertarian candidates elected so that they can implement libertarian policy. It's never going to happen, ever, ever, ever. If your goal is to do that, you're probably going to have far more success joining the GOP or joining the DNC, where at least the DNC has power. They actually know a way to win, and that those kind of intra-party conflicts are very toned down. Even with Donald Trump, when Donald Trump took over the GOP, basically, and, you know, the MAGA people kind of took over, there was some pushback. But then, you know, once they won, they kind of was like, okay, I guess we're you now. I guess, and then they all kind of embraced it. For good or ill, they embraced it. And this is not what's happening within the LP. The Mises Caucus took it over in a very similar way, just kind of walked in and said, we're running things now. Got their people, fairly elected, and now everybody's accusing everybody of being a Nazi. It's because parties that have power are very aware that infighting is a great way to lose power. So, you know, they have their part, you know, they have their fights during the primaries and stuff like that. And then once the dust is settled on the primaries, they all kind of bang together and say, look, we got to hold our nose and vote for these guys. And there's going to be a few holdouts. There's going to be like the Never Trumpers, right? But as election day got closer, they kind of went away. And after he got elected, they were completely gone. Except for Bill Kristol, who, you know, I think that the best way to solve the libertarian problem overall is just to disband the LP. I don't think that the good things outweigh the bad things. And if you really want to join, if you really want to actually have electoral wins, you need to join an actual party that can actually win, who is actually holding ground, right? I don't think it's possible for you to go and start a second party in China, and I don't think it's possible for you to get a third one in the United States. So that's my video. And because I'm going to be clipping this out, this is part of a longer live stream. If you want to subscribe, go ahead and do that. We do live streams more. I'm actually going to upload this on my old channel, and this is where I am now. If that's what you want, go and do that. So until next time, worms.